Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back. If you would please take your seats. We'd like to start the second half of our second day of Black Portraitures 2, Imaging the Black Bodies and Restaging Histories. The panel coming is Contemporary Art and Cultural Diplomacy, Art and Embassies, Program Artists. Our moderator is Robert Sapelsa. Our panelists, McLean Thomas, Sanford Biggers, Carrie Mae Weems, and another guest has joined us today, Florence Ladd.
Buonasera. I'd like to just take a few moments to introduce Florence Ladd. We're so, so happy to have Florence Ladd join our panel this afternoon. As many of you know, Florence Ladd is an author, a critic. She's also a psychologist and a fiction writer. Her novel, Sarah Somme, which was published in 1996, received the 1997 Literary Award for Fiction from the American Library Association's Black Caucus. She was educated at Howard University and the University of Rochester and has had an extensive career as a teacher and administrator. She's taught at Simmons College, Roberts College, American College for Girls in Istanbul, Harvard Graduate School of Education, and Harvard Graduate School of Design. I actually met her as a freshman at Wellesley College, where she was the dean at Wellesley, and also she served as a dean at MIT. From 1989 to 1997, she was the director of the Bunting Institute at Harvard University, a multidisciplinary center for women in higher education. And very notable about her career is that she worked for Oxfam America, initially as Director of Education Programs and later as an Associate Executive Director. She was a consultant for the School of International Training in Zimbabwe Projects. I'd like to mention, and it would be remiss of me not to mention her novels, especially that the paperback edition of Sarah Somm has a cover photograph by Carrie Mae Weems, our own Carrie Mae Weems, so we're very excited about that. The Spirit of Josephina from 2014 is another of her noted works, the Côte d'Or Press. Jason Henderson's Senior Year is a work that's coming out in 2016, set on Yale's campus. And look out in June 15, just in a couple of days now, for her work. It's a work of poetry entitled Reclaiming Rose, and she'll be reading from that for us today. So her bio was not in the program. I hope you've taken that all in. And without further ado, I'm looking forward to the panel coming on up and joining us on the stage. Thank you.
Are we on? We're on. Let's get right to it. I'm Bob Sopelsa. I'm senior curator for the Art in Embassies office at the United States State Department. You're looking now at our recently designed new logo and at all of the ways you can find us on the web. We are Twittering, we are Facebooking, we are YouTubing, and we are, it's not called Flashdance, it's called Flashpoint, or one of those, I forget which, the photos. And of course, this is fairly new. We actually had to get permission from the State Department to have our own kind of website. They wanted us to have an official one that was all about the government, and we're not. We're all about art, and all about art as a part of the diplomatic conversation. I have three artists up here with me on stage, Sanford Biggers, Micheline Thomas, and Carrie Mae Weems, who have exhibited in our exhibitions and who are included in our collections worldwide. We do two things. We place exhibitions temporarily in the houses of American ambassadors, which change every 3 years, the ambassadors. There are 180 embassies. And so we change exhibitions about 60 times a year. There are seven curators and, in principle, three registrars in the office, and then the support people who work with us on all of these things. But also, since 2005, our mandate has expanded to place collections of art permanently in American embassies as new embassies are built around the world. Since the events, the horrible events in Dar es Salaam and Nairobi in the past century, it was decided that embassy security had to be beefed up all over the world. And so the State Department is building 12 new embassies a year, about 12 new embassies a year. And they decided, in the government's wisdom, that maybe it would be a good idea to have these places look a little bit less like fortresses and a little bit more like places where people would enjoy going. So they gave a small part of every budget for the purchase of art collections, and they entrusted the curators in this office, the Art and Embassies office, to do it, since we had worked with so many artists, and there are, I am sure, many more artists in the audience than I could either name or know, because I've only been with the program for 13 years. The program's been around for 50 years and more. So we're busy. And what I want to do is talk to you a little bit about what we do and how we do it. I'm waiting. And we will begin with a 5-minute video, which was made to celebrate our 50th anniversary, and the new programs called Art Exchanges that accompany these programs. Run it.
And the idea is that
this is Pedro Reyes, Mexican artist who designed an exterior piece for the embassy in Tijuana.
So what this is the year. It's basically the inner ear, you know, that has this kind of coil. Art is something that should allow people to talk, but not about the piece, but just like talk about larger aspects of life. Mission accomplished.
That's our chief curator, Virginia Shore, with him.
It's not that it's about this piece of metal here, it's about the other discussions that are yet to come.
Diplomacy is a conversation.
With the large embassy project.
Nick Cave, a commission for the new embassy building in Dakar.
Putting out what I've devoted my life to in a situation
Kiki Smith
that represents
for Mumbai.
For me, a great honor. Culture is our greatest asset, and it's what we have the most to offer and share with the culture and the creativity of other parts of the world.
Representing your nation is very, very meaningful, and it's something that you take with a great sense of responsibility.
This is Jeff Koons in Beijing.
On your journey of art, you start to get an understanding of the power of art. It's a very, very powerful tool.
It's a privilege to be a citizen of Nevada, to be part of this long history that our embassies has established. Immediately, I saw how amazing the program
is. This is Jim Drain in Rabat.
It wasn't just about placing works, it was about this exchange with different cultures through the embassy.
This was also a collaborative piece, as was Nick's.
In Ukrainian craft, there's this really intricate lace work in my work and in this piece.
Glass artist Graham Caldwell.
Intense, complex.
In Kiev.
We have the opportunity here to show American artists.
Ambassador John Teft with him.
I was thrilled to go to China last spring, and I went to the American Embassy to participate in a cultural exchange, and I met with Asian artists. This type of interaction, that's what's exciting about the cultural exchange part of the Art Embassy's program.
You think about the embassy being a little piece of one country in another country.
This is Margaret Boozer, a Maryland ceramic artist.
Earth from Maryland that is going over to Djibouti and is going to live there in the U.S. Embassy.
My project involved making a sculpture for the embassy in Rabat, Morocco, and we did it collaboratively with students at RISD. The students and I were really coming from the same place of like exploring what it meant to make an artwork for an embassy and what a cultural exchange meant.
We're here at the U.S. Embassy in Madagascar, where I've just completed my installation.
Maya Freelan Asante.
It's been around the world, but now it's got a final resting place.
In Madagascar.
Here in Madagascar.
The way art automatically makes connections, it makes cultural connections, and these connections go past borders and past times. The Art Embassy's program complements very well the work that's taking place.
Tsai Guo Zhang creating a piece for Beijing.
To bring cultures together. So it's not just that it's this American art, but it's a celebration and a joy, a uniting joy of what it means to be human. It's this activity of defining what our possibilities can be and the sharing, which transcends cultures.
They say it so much better than I could. Over the past 52 years, I've only been with it for 13 years, but the office has worked with more than 20,000 constituents, artists, museums, foundations, galleries, collectors, anyone who would be interested in having art from their collection or creating art for a collection that would become a part of the diplomatic conversation. We began with a small program that was inspired actually by an early exchange program at the Museum of Modern Art, the International Office at the Museum of Modern Art, that sent to the, what do we call them, the high-end embassies. But then it was realized that this was very successful and that the art decorating ambassadors' residences, I use that word decorating, and that's okay. Art's first perfect purpose is decoration. That this art would help contribute. Whoa. There we go. There are more than 200 exhibitions and collections in embassies and consulates today. I'm going to begin talking a little bit about the temporary exhibitions. Here we have a piece by Carrie Mae Weems, yes, in the residence of the UN ambassador. It's up in the Waldorf Astoria Hotel in New York. Carrie Mae has been a very generous participant in our programs in recent years and continues to work with us on projects. Here's a piece by a man who was supposed to be on the panel but couldn't make it, Whitford Lovell, which is currently in Pretoria, an example of the very sympathetic portrayal of his African-American compatriots. Next, you're going to see, I believe, a piece by Fred Wilson, another artist who was supposed to be on the panel. Yes, in fact, I just installed or supervised the installation of this piece in the UN, in the US ambassador's residence in Vienna, Austria. It took the place of a 19th century reproduction of a Baroque mirror. This piece, with its multivalent meanings and its incredible dense beauty, becomes a much more interesting decoration for the embassy than that plain old mirror was, and it still functions as a mirror. This is one of his mirrors from his Otello series. Next, we have a piece that has been in numerous exhibitions. This is Gordon Parks' portrait of Ella Watson. Again, a very sympathetic, very multivalent image which reflects history in its references back to Grant Wood, but also reflects the reality of a blue-collar government worker and her life. Here we are looking at collections in which we began 10 years ago thinking diplomacy should not be a lecture. It should not just be art by Americans. It should be a conversation. That's what diplomacy is all about. And so we began including art by local artists as well as American artists. And here you have a piece by Zambian artist Stari Mwaba hanging in the US Embassy in Lusaka, Zambia. Here's Micheline, one of your pieces that hangs in Khartoum, part of the collection, and it livens up a very, which would otherwise be a kind of a grim lobby space. And let's, believe me, folks, I'm trying. There we go. Micheline Thomas. Hey, good for you, Micheline, and good for us for having it. That was another piece that I was installing. Here is Sanford's Lotus, which is in Antananarivo, another piece of very multivalent meaning and significance, and a piece that ends up being of great beauty, but also a piece that, when you look at it in detail, is remarkably poignant. And these are now permanently. Here's Nick Cave's installation in Dakar, 24 feet high, 22 feet wide, about 500 pounds altogether. I was also in on the installation of this one, which was a tough one. It doesn't like me. There we go. Okay, time. Yes, and we publish catalogs and labels and encourage the public affairs offices of the embassies to participate in the exhibitions. This is the catalog for the collection in Ouagadougou, installed in 2009. This catalog, by the way, does not exist on paper. It exists only electronically. I suppose people can print it if they want, but the idea is, with the greening initiative, that we do as much electronically as we are able to do. And I finally return to how you find us, how you tweet about what you've seen here, how you respond to us. And if you are an artist interested in participating, how you reach us through our website under Submitting Art. And now I am sending it on to our next speaker, who is Carrie May. No, it's Sanford.
Good afternoon, everyone. How you doing? Buonasera. So first of all, I'd like to say it's an honor and a privilege and a joy to be here in Firenze with my colleagues and illustrious guests. This is an incredible moment, and it's actually a bit nostalgic for me because a lot of my career started right here in Firenze, where I studied for a year while I was a junior at Morehouse College. I will not mention the name of the place where I stayed, but it was here in Firenze for a year. Some people call it Syracuse. But but it's interesting because this whole notion of being an ambassador or a diplomat via your artwork really hit home to me at that point, because I realized when I was here studying art in Italian, it wasn't just about the work that I made, but the presence that I had while being here. Obviously, going to school at Morehouse prepared me for that in a way to deal with living in the U.S., but being outside of the U.S. changed the spectrum of my trajectory a great deal. And I realized just by being in a space was a statement in and of itself. Somehow, I think that translates into my work, because I rarely use the figure in a referential way. Figures come about here and there, but I think I'm very interested in actually the absence of a figure. And I think this is largely because of my hypervisibility and invisibility, depending on the context of where I may be. I know many of you in the audience and even on the panel understand this. Honestly, there's a power in that invisibility and hypervisibility. Sometimes I loathe both, sometimes I love both. So, given any day. So let's start with an image. Okay, so it's gonna take a second to come up, but I'm going to talk about the three pieces that I've had through this program at various times. So I've had work that was at the ambassador's residence in Tokyo. Once again, I should mention I lived in Japan for 3 years, so I started a relationship with people and many different networks in Japan at that point, and was later asked to put a piece in one of the shows at the embassy there, which I'll get into in a second. So I will start by giving you a preface to that work. So can we just run this video very quickly? And if you could turn the volume down just a bit, I'll speak over it. Okay, good. So while I was living in Japan, I got very interested in Buddhism and notions of performance and the body in space and ritual and so on. And upon moving back to the States, I wanted to approach my work with a bit of a autobiographical angle. And growing up in Los Angeles, I was a student of all the hip-hop arts. Breakdancing, graffiti, DJing, and MCing. So this was actually an homage to that point in my life where I would go to the local dojo and practice breakdance moves with my crew. Right here, I've made this dance floor that you're looking at, which was later used for international breakdance competitions. Okay. So once again, back to absence. When the sculpture is actually shown, and this is it behind me, it's shown in a quiet space, usually somewhere on an adjacent wall. On a very small monitor embedded within the wall is the video that you just saw, and you can only listen to it within headphones. So the idea is to approach this much like you would approach a minimalist or post-minimalist work. There's references to Carl Andre and so on. But when you find that small monitor and put on the headphones, you're then transformed into the space where that breakdance battle took place. And, you know, speaking of presence and absence, this piece is shown all around the world, and everywhere it goes, I make an arrangement with the museum or the gallery to allow a few days out of the week where anyone off the street can come in and dance directly on the piece. So over time, it shows that use patina, the scuff marks, the sort of ethnographic survey of the activities that take place on it. And this was, you know, just a side view of the event to give you an idea of how many people were there and the kind of people that were there. This is another much more silent piece, and intentionally silent. This is a boombox that was melted down, and the piece is called The Bridge Is Over. Many of you, I'm sure, know the reference to the MC Shan KRS-One battle about the birthplace of hip hop, and this was my memorialization of hip hop, which died in 2005. Don't sleep. You're listening to hip hop, not hip hop. But you can still find the hip hop, you know what I mean. But so this right here is a memorial to that moment. And let's see. So it's a piece about sound, but obviously it is silent. And it is about absence once again. And the piece that wound up in the Tokyo show, I think, follows this stream of thought and is this piece, which I call Orin, which is the Japanese term for a Shinto-style ancestral worship singing bell or singing bowl. And the one that you're looking at, I made by melting down hip-hop jewelry, fat gold chains, fronts, rings, bracelets that I purchased in Harlem and then later purchased some in Tokyo. And I worked with several artisans to melt it down into an alloy, press it, and then form it into an actual usable singing bowl. And inscribed is hip hop nisasagu, which means in fond memory of hip hop. And to, you know, extend the life of this, because I do consider these in some ways ethnographic objects, this was used in a bell ceremony that I created with 16 participants, some international, some Japanese, some of us in full kimono, some in street clothes, including the head monk of the temple where it took place. And the image that you see, I won't show video because of time, but the image you see right here is a very large singing bowl being played by one of the participants. And the silver one that you saw previously was played by the head monk. So this starts another series of works that happened a few years after the bell that you saw. This is a bit of a buildup. This piece is called Cheshire, and I got even more interested in this idea of invisibility and visibility. And this particular picture is shown where this sculpture, it's a light box sculpture that was hung on the edge of the Black Forest in Germany, and it's called Cheshire. And for most Europeans walking by, the name Cheshire, of course, evokes Lewis Carroll, Alice in Wonderland, and so on. But when I changed this location and showed it in Virginia, it immediately became Richmond, Virginia, about blackface minstrelsy. And I was very interested in the duality of the symbol. So it reappears in my work. I consider it almost a character. This is it as a billboard in Los Angeles on La Brea. And then later, this is in New York at the Sculpture Center, hung by one point, dangling in the wind and bouncing against the wall at a show I had. And the person in there is just for scale. But of course, I look at blackface minstrelsy once again as something that disappears and reappears, hypervisibility, invisibility. This piece is presently at the Brooklyn Museum. The sound you hear is coming from the piano. This is a modified piano. I turned it into a player piano, and it's playing my own rendition of Strange Fruit. So that's me performing. The tree is a sculpted tree, and you can see the Shesher hanging like a crescent moon above it. And this is just some close-up and different angles of the same piece. This is called Blossom. Thank you.
That's fabulous.
And within this series of work came the Lotus piece that later ended up in an Antananarivo. And this is the original version, and this is a glass piece. And this was also hung in the Brooklyn Museum. This is around 7.5 foot diameter piece of glass. And as you look at it from a distance, it is entitled Lotus. This goes back to my Japanese experience and Buddhism. The lotus obviously is a symbol for purity, wholeness, wellness, transcendence. As you know, it goes from the muck and mire of a body of water and rises to the top until it blossoms. But if you get closer to this particular lotus, you realize that each petal actually are slave ships, and these are all hand-etched into glass, over 6,000 figures. So in this instance, the figure does appear, although they're rather amorphous and just sort of hinting at the bodies. But purposely, the piece is left clear, hollow in the center, so as viewers walk around it, they are seen through that absence. So you see other people through the glass, meaning that we are all implied in this international economical trade of bodies. Not just African slavery has existed before. But, okay, so, and you saw the version that was in the embassy. This was later commissioned by the city of New York, and I made a much larger version. This is 30 feet diameter. It weighs around 2 tons, and this is steel on the side of the Eagle Academy for Young Men in the Bronx, which is a charter school started by the 100 Black Men. Mm. Very cool. Let's see. Okay, and this gets me to the last body of work. One of these pieces, I started a series of paintings directly on antique quilts. And a brief background to this whole series, which I call the Codex series. In my research, on the Underground Railroad, quilts were used as signposts. And if they were folded a certain way, hung a certain way, or displaying a certain pattern, it signaled to escaping slaves whether a safe house was free, whether it was under surveillance, or even at times giving coordinates and directions of how to travel north to freedom. This has been contended by academics for many, many years, but the kernel of that remains in vernacular history, and for me, that's enough to go on. And I've used this as a backdrop to then acquire several antique quilts, nothing after the 1900s. And I take them and I paint, I use spray paint, oil stick, acrylic, I sew other fabrics directly onto them. Some are in total disrepair, and then I use other quilts to make them whole again. And I consider this to be a cross-generational, cross-cultural dialogue with the original fabricators and sewers and makers of these pieces. And I think it exists in a very interesting space because it questions notions of women's art, men's art, beautification, defacing. Basically, it's American history. So these are a backdrop, and I'm just going to show you a few images of some of these pieces. This particular one is in the ambassador of South Africa, the US ambassador to South Africa, Patrick Gaspard's home in Pretoria. Mm-hmm. And this quilt is from 1875. This is a study for one of them. And you can see a lot of vestiges from Tibetan and Buddhist art directly in here as I use graphically. And it's a combination of textiles that I purchased, old clothes, and old quilts, all reconformed and collaged in this particular study. This is on paper. Oh, I'm sorry, I misspoke. This is the actual one that's at Patrick Gaspard's home. And speaking once again to the notion of absence, I've started embedding a lot of codes into these quilts because I consider myself to be the next bearer of code in that process. So in the future when these are looked at, you're looking at 200, 300 years of American history as defined by the authors of these pieces, myself included. And within this one, is there a pointer on this? Is it the top red button, maybe? Yes. Very hidden to the eye is a silhouette, and it's on its side. And I embed these in a lot of my pieces. I call them specters and ghosts. I sometimes even call them spooks. And that one, many of you may recognize from this image right here. So basically, I started to consider Harriet Tubman an astronaut, navigating the stars to lead people to freedom, as she was. I also started to consider the patterns of scarification on Gordon or Whipped Pete's back as potential plot points for constellations as well. So once again, it still goes back to the notion of Lotus, transcendence, absence, getting beyond the body, getting beyond the physical into a spiritual realm. So I'll just go right back to that other quilt and show you where the body exists again. There's the elbow, the arm, he's on his side. Okay, thank you.
Wow. I'm gonna ask Micheline Thomas to talk next about her art and what she's done with Art and Embassies.
Thank you, Robert.
Sure.
That was fantastic, Sanford. Buonasera, and this is my first time in Italy, so I'm very excited to be here in Firenze. And I actually was very honored to be invited to be on a panel because I would have an opportunity to come to Italy in Florence. And so I actually took extra time to travel throughout Italy to see other parts of the country, from Capri to Rome to Venice Biennial. And during that time, really taking in the landscape and photographing and thinking about the history and my presence and sort of my journey in this new space. A lot of my work has not been as international as most on the panel. And so one of the opportunities many years ago when the Arts and Embassy had reached out to me in my gallery to participate, to loan my painting to Khartoum in Sudan, I was very excited to have that as a presentation and presence in a different country. And then since then, I've been invited by the director, Virginia Shore, to participate in another project and commissioned to do a 100-foot mural in Senegal, in Dakar, at the U.S. Embassy's new facade. Which has been very exciting. So when I was asked to do this project, one of the things that came to mind for me and its idea of diplomacy was to be really engaged with the communities surrounding the embassy and not just be a U.S. artist coming in and sort of throwing up a mural. I was really interested in notions of collaboration and sort of what the artists were doing in the community. And so I requested part of the commission project for me to actually go there, since I actually hadn't been to Senegal. It would be my first time in Dakar, to really engage with the community and the people at hand, so that way I could sort of provide images for my landscape. So I will go through the slide presentation and talk about, mainly my presentation is the process and images for the mural itself. I think some of, so what you see here actually, as Robert pointed out, is a still life painting that I did actually many years ago, and 2009 for Khatoum. It was actually made specifically for them when I was invited to be a part of that program. Several times throughout the conversation with Virginia, they were really excited about that one still life that I did for Khatoum. And at some point, I believe, Ambassador Susan Rice had seen some of my work and really responded to it. And when she responded to my work, she really wanted for some of the art to be hung in her place and her at her residence in New York. And she had seen this image at my exhibition at the time in Chicago. And this painting is titled Girlfriend and Lovers. And I was really excited that she wanted this in her home, this large painting. But each time we would loan her a painting, a museum would purchase it for their collection. And so she was very disappointed. And I promised her at one point that I would make one specifically for her home. And spoke to Virginia about it and made this particular painting behind me. And this particular painting, when I made it for Susan Rice, it's titled Portrait of Manja. And I made this particular painting for her home because I was thinking about, at the time, Susan Rice's presence and who she was and who she represented in the world as an ambassador. And wanted to sort of signify this very sort of powerful black woman and sort of present her in this sort of composition where she was really owning her space. And Susan Rice was very excited, and so I put her in sort of these clothing of like representing sort of America, the red, white, and blue, and have it as a sort of portrait of her, but not of her directly, but more sort of a sort of signifier of sort of who she was iconically in the world as this very powerful black woman in government. But then again, once again, this painting was then removed from her home and into another collection, which is actually hanging up at the National Portrait Gallery. To move on with the project in Senegal, I wanted to present the process of the work. As I stated, when I was in Senegal, I was really having conversation and engagement with some of the artists, but while there, taking a lot of photographs. And part of my process and my work, to give you a little background, is photographic based, but also collage, very heavily rooted in sort of assemblage and a collage. And it's really important for me as an artist to own my own images by documenting sort of the environments in which I sort of travel, to have my own resources that I can pull from and sort of the process of making my paintings. And so when I returned, I needed to make a sort of maquette of the mural, because the mural is 100 feet long, horizontal, and 14 feet high on the longer end. And so while I was there, I wanted the mural to represent the environment, but also by talking to the people, what was very important to them, and what was very important to them as far as their landscape and sort of the history of their landscape and sort of images, and wanted to keep the figure out of it, because a lot of my murals relate to the landscape in a sense of the representation of self and journey and where we navigate from one point to the other. And also through these conversations, what was really interesting, some of the dialogue I had with some of the artists, I wanted them to decide which areas of the mural they would actually sort of collaborate with by making some sections for them to actually present some of their ideas. So these are just references of landscapes that I did in the past to propose to the Arts and Embassy program. And we'll get to some of the resources. And so what you'll see on the left are some photographic resources that I took while I was in Dakar. And speaking with the people about what was important to them in their environment. And now what you see here are that's actually a detail of a collage for it. Sorry, it's just moving very slow. These are closer details of the collage because it's very long, and then I will get to, I can't really see. So here are some of the artisans. The mural, I should really specify that the mural's actually being made in three places. It's being partially fabricated in upstate New York, here in Italy, and also in Dakar. And that was really important for me to sort of utilize some of the traditional techniques of mosaics and where they sort of come from in the history of that. And so the mural actually has various techniques that really sort of express the traditional way of making, from smalti to glass making to digital. And so these are actually some of the artisans in upstate New York. But this is a detail of a section of the mural.
So it's all mosaic?
It's all mosaic, yes. And some of the images, it was really important for me, as I do with my collages, to have various genres presented sort of photographically and also sort of traditional sort of ways of cutting sort of the mosaic where you present it with the form and shape. The empty space that you see there will be presented by an artist that I chose to work with me in Segal. His name is Penang. He's a fantastic young artist in Dakar who, through his proposal, presented some images that really integrate with the mural overall to really make it sort of suggestive with the images. There's some very terracotta techniques as well used. One thing that was really exciting for me is to really work with these artisans in the detail that they go to length to sort of make these murals. We've been working on it for about a year and a half, and finally it is completed, and the mural will be installed, thankfully, this year in November. So I get to go back to Senegal and Dakar for about 2 weeks to work with the Senegalese artists to install the piece, but also do a series of workshops with the kids in Senegal to actually participate with the installation. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Micheline. And now, to expand the expression of the panel, we're going to have some readings by Florence Ladd from her work.
When Carrie Mae Weems
asked me about my interest in this event, I told her that my work has to do with people who've not been represented, with a project brought to me, in effect, about my great-grandmother, my maternal great-grandmother, for whom I have no images. There are no pictures of her, no drawings, nothing. And she was illiterate. She was born a slave in 1836, and she died a slave in 1909, born on an island, Portsmouth Island, off North Carolina, one of the Outer Banks Islands, where she lived out her life, an island bypassed by the end of the Civil War. And some of you may have ancestors too, for whom there are no pictures, there's no portraiture, there's some family lore perhaps, but no images to draw on. So this is a brief presentation without images. I heard about my great-grandmother from time to time through my mother's perennial, more than perennial, monologues. Some of you may have known my mother from the laughter out there. She was a teacher in Washington, D.C. And one of the first poems in a series, a suite of poems called Reclaiming Rose, will tell you something about, I heard about my great-grandmother, who was named Rose. One Sunday morning, while Mom irons, I sit at the kitchen table reading the comics. She pauses and says, "Did I ever tell you how your great-grandmother died?" I look up from Popeye and Olive, ready to take in another retelling of family history, unready to say, "But you've told me a dozen times about the dreadful saga that intrigues her and needs retelling." Beginning as she always does, once upon a time, she waits for my eyes to meet hers. Once upon a time, your great-grandmother Rose, while roasting oysters outside, was burned alive. She lived on an island off North Carolina. A beauty she was, said to be half black, the other half said to be Cherokee. Her long skirts caught fire. Burned alive, she went to heaven in a blaze. During her recitation, the ironing stops and only resumes when I look sorrowful. Never knowing what to say, I bow my head as if to pray. Too late to pray for Rose. A 10-year-old, I picture the scene. The fire engulfs billowing petticoats. She screams and writhes in the flames, the image rekindled with each retelling. And now I tell and retell the story as if there is rescue in retelling. Now, as for the backstory of this, I was told, and I knew my grandparents, my maternal grandparents, and I knew that my maternal grandfather was said to be half white. Only later I wondered, why not half black? Why do we say half white? There was no reference to his paternity. And it was an unexplored mystery About 3 years ago, I received a query from an amateur white historian in North Carolina who said she had been collecting information about the black family on Portsmouth Island. She said she wanted to write a book, a fictional account of Rose's life, but Rose's story made her sad, and she wanted to pass on the material to somebody in the family, as if Rose's story doesn't make me sad. It made me revisit Portsmouth Island, which is uninhabited now and was uninhabitable when Rose lived there, and to decide how to make use of the mostly census data and material extracted from family Bibles that the historian had collected about, essentially about Rose and her family. And from that, I learned that Rose was the mother of seven children, that she had given each child the name of the master who was responsible for the paternity. I knew that my grandfather and his brother had different last names, but I didn't put that together until I saw her documentation. And in that, I was able to identify my great-grandfather. I knew that my grandfather had said his father was named Ben. I learned some things about my great-grandfather. Learned that he was married and fathered a child the same year, a child named William, the same year my grandfather was born to Rose. I could tell you more, but keep in mind there are no images, no drawings, nothing about Rose. And so when I took on this project, I realized I couldn't take on writing a work of fiction about her, but I would attempt a suite of poems. And Reclaiming Rose, which is being published in the month of June, next month, by Finishing Line Press, contains a collection of poems, that narrative poems, about her life. And insofar as one, as I could construct an image of her life, but not of her, I've written some poems in her voice, and I'll read a couple of them. Rose's meditation. You want to know how I come to be here, born here, on this strip of sandy land, sold at age 11 by the Gatskills with their other possessions, ironware, crockeryware, fire tongs, table, tubs, bedstead, bed, and a looking glass. I looked long into that looking glass, saw a face the color of my hands, not the hue of the Gatskill girls, but with the same nose, gray-green Gatskill eyes, my skin, a blend of theirs and the tint of my mother's. Lord, I want to know how I come to be here. Rose's soliloquy. She has two soliloquies in this collection. This is the second one. Happy? I heard them say we happy. No, not happy here at their beck and call. happy when alone with my own kind, happy holding close my own children to comfort them, gladden their hearts. Happy when I sing to them the old songs my mother sang to give me might and ease. Happy when I dream the day of walking on land I own, waking in a house that's mine, happy at the sight of winged creatures, geese, gulls, loons, taking flight. Happy, trusting in the Lord to call me when his work through me is done. And finally, my note, kind of memo to Rose. Consumed by an inferno on earth, delivered from life's misery, I pray you are in a heavenly campground wearing a long white robe, golden slippers, with a gospel choir singing the spiritual, "Trouble Don't Last Always." May angels gather and comfort you and give your free soul sweet peace. Thank you.
At least, speaking for myself, that brought me to tears. That's beautiful. And now, some words from Carrie Mae Weems.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi. The generations are at the table. Florence, thank you. Can we bring down the house lights, please? Bring down the house lights, please. Thank you. Rather than an overarching theme, we gather in Venice. There are 86 countries. It's the 120th year anniversary. And I'm thinking about Oqui and Wurzer. Can you raise the volume? Slightly louder, please.
I can see that we're on a lagoon. I can see water. I can see towers and rooftops. I can see across the great expanse of time. I can see my soul soaring and searching. I can see myself yielding to beauties unimaginable. I can see myself being seduced. I can see myself crying as I walk these streets, these alleyways, these ancient ruins of time. From the Byzantine to the early Renaissance, and on and on and on and on and on, the city has seen the march of time. It shows us enormous architecture, great churches, amazing cathedrals. It shows us the most important paintings that the world has ever produced. It gives us music and melody. To the Rotunda Torre at Palatinos. myself back up 10 flights of stairs to the top of a place, in a space, in a time, overlooking Venice. From here I have a bird's eye view, and I can see the birds in the background. I can see the mountains. I can see that we're on a lagoon. I can see water. I can see towers and rooftops. I can see across the great expanse of time. I can see my soul soaring and searching. I can see myself yielding to beauties unimaginable. I can see myself being seduced. I can see myself crying as I walk these streets, these alleyways, these ancient ruins of time. From the Byzantine to the early Renaissance, and on and on and on and on and on, the city has seen the march of time. It shows us enormous architecture, great churches, amazing cathedrals. It shows us the most important paintings that the world has ever produced. It gives us music and melody. I'm grateful. From Sorrento to the Rotunda Torre of Palatinos, enormous church. I am all. So across this century, across these backdrops, rather I should say within this city, this ancient ruin of time, Oquia Worser has mounted his show, the Venice Biennale 2015. An enormous work of great importance, standing up and standing next to the Baroque, the Medieval, the Early Renaissance, the Late Renaissance, the Roman Empire, and its expansion. Here we see that something has come home to roost. Young boys and young girls who played out their lives in the colonies have left those colonies and now come to the mainland. They've come to the mainland in search of work. They've come to the mainland in search of opportunity. They've come to the mainland in search of gold. They've come to the land, to this land, in order to find themselves in a new way, in a new time, in a new century, in a new era. Set of new questions now. We're not harkening back to the Roman Empire. We're now questioning empire. And in this exhibition, we are questioning the role of states and governments. We're questioning the role of democracy and the ability of democracy to handle its civic duty to its citizens. Question of power, orchestrations of power, as it finds itself, or rather I should say, as it expresses itself in late capitalism, in a city that was built upon enormous enormous riches, and vast riches as a result of tremendous trade. It's really not a surprise that the Venice Biennale really is here in Venice. It makes all the sense in the world. It was here that worlds collided. It was here that worlds were brought together. It was here that all of the exchange and understanding be the bedrock of capital and of power are really located here as they moved away from Rome and began to shift here as a site of the new. Against this backdrop that O'Quee and Wurzer has constructed the Venice Biennale in 2015. There are problems, to be sure. There is no exhibition that comes without its problems. There are things that are unresolved, and there are problems that are problems, but they're not massive. The more important thing is that there are a group of artists on parade, the likes of which the Venice Biennale has never seen before. They have names that end in I and O and A. And you, they hail from Africa, Asia, South America, India. It's a new land. It's a new land. It's a new time. And they're posing new questions, new possibilities. I suppose, really, that's what it means to have democracy. And that's what it means to have cultural diplomacy. Cultural diplomacy really is the meaning of the words in a central location. Cultural diplomacy is the meaning of the words in a central location, where everyone meets on equal terms, without the layers of power to disrupt us, but rather to use all of those things in the service of what is best, what is good, and what is right, and what is just, and what is moral. So we meet you here, at the edge of the new worlds, on the edge of chaos, at the Venice Biennale 2015, headed by O'Quee and Wurzer, asking us to ask the larger questions about what art is, how it functions, and who it serves.
And thank you.
So when I went there, I just knew that I had planned a whole other presentation. And then when I went to the Biennale, I just thought that I needed to really make something about it. That that if I was going to be on a panel addressing issues of art and diplomacy, what better place to sort of think about that? And so it was really kind of a gift. I went into an installation there, and I sat down, and I just talked to myself, and that text is what you heard as I just talked to myself sitting in a room looking at art. So I'm very grateful, and I wanted to start the evening this afternoon also just with that music by Armstrong, because of course Louis Armstrong had been so incredibly important to art and diplomacy, other musicians as well, Duke Ellington and Dizzy, Wynton Marsalis continues to be in right now. There are a whole group of extraordinary musicians, David Murray and James Young, and et cetera, all just a few hours away from here, continuing, I think, that sort of profound tradition of opening up space and opening up territory for the possibility to imagine the ways in which we might cross those cultural divides. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Carrie May. That was inspiring. Lovely. Do we have time for questions?
Yes, we have a few minutes for questions and comments.
We got one back there. There's one over here.
Anna, thank you so much for that presentation. I wonder if... my name is Ebony Koletu. I'm at Penn State University. And I worked for 5 years in Egypt at the American University in Cairo, and so I kind of come at the cultural diplomacy question a little bit differently, because I think it's often framed, or more frequently framed, as a question of soft power. And it's difficult because some of your favorite artists are often recruited into a project where they have a delicate balancing act. And that's the critical cultural work that you do on the one hand, and the problem of sponsorship on the other. So I guess I just wondered if each of you could reflect on the problem of sponsorship, not because anyone's trying to take money out of, you know, what should be compensated labor, but because sometimes sponsorship changes the way you speak about your own work. Is that a weird noise, right? So I guess I just wonder if you feel that. Does sponsorship in this context change the way you speak about your own work such that it's more challenging to talk about soft power, to talk about cultural diplomacy, to talk about the places where your work lands and what it might mean, whether or not it's modifying the reputation of the United States or whether or not it is involved in a conversation? I don't know if that's clear enough, but that's just a question that surfaced for me.
You mean, are we compromised? are we compromised by money? That's really the question.
I'm going to let the artists speak here.
Yes, I've sold out. I've given up all principle.
Tell it like it is, right?
Right. So I'm just trying to make a living. No. I mean, of course, I understand your question absolutely, and I think that it's one to be always considered. And I would imagine that maybe other people have different kinds of experiences. But you know, frankly, for me, it's a I've been commissioned several times over the last few years, and I've been really grateful for those commissions. Actually, they really haven't changed very much in the way in which I talk about things, really. It really allows me sort of to expand on ideas that maybe I would not necessarily have the opportunity to do before because I didn't have that commission. So it hasn't really impacted me in that way, but I do understand the situation, and I do think that it can have an impact. But I haven't had really, nobody's given me enough money to like sell myself short yet.
Micheline, you've been involved in a true collaboration with the artists in Senegal.
Yeah, but for me, there haven't really been any sort of financial, sort of any compromises because of the financial support. I mean, the experience there when I proposed my idea was really opened and sort of welcomed immediately. So if anything, I was fortunate to work with the organization with resources that allow me to pick the fabricators that I wanted to work with and sort of expand on inviting other artists to participate so that they could also benefit from this project. So, I mean, although, you know, as an artist, there are some compromises you have to make, but in this particular situation, it was really fantastic to sort of just go in and do exactly what I want to do without any compromises.
Right. Yeah. Sanford, you want to say something?
Yeah, in my three instances, I was, as I mentioned, I've lived in Japan for 3 years, so I was very embedded there. So I had a relationship with lots of people from various sectors. And South Africa, I spent a few weeks there with South African artists going around between Pretoria, Cape Town, Joburg, going to townships, doing lectures and so on, and dialogues. So I felt like there was some interaction there. But most important to me as an artist was that, you know, my voice is in my work, and my work never changed for the commissions. And if we think about it in diplomacy, I don't think there's one cure-all for any of these situations, but I look at these opportunities, these commissions, as invitations to go and then speak your truth, speak your word and dialogue, and hopefully have some influence and gain some inspiration and education in the process. Mm-hmm. And for me, that has been the case. You know, America is what it is, and our relationship is what it is. And I think the artists I'm here on this panel, once again, we have our voice. And I don't know, maybe they're trying to push it a little further by letting us speak in some of these places. It's very small, but it is an introduction at least to some alternative images, ideas, and opinions, you know, of course, via America.
But we're also talking about, you know, working with some fairly progressive people as well. Mm-hmm. Right? I mean, Virginia Shore is a very progressive, very interesting, very dynamic woman. But also, you know, when you sort of start to think about, you know, for instance, this conference. Mm-hmm. This conference is a conference of cultural diplomacy. Right? Headed by, backed by, supported by very interesting, very powerful institutions. But I don't necessarily think that, from what I've seen, that the voices have necessarily been mitigated in any way because of the support that they've received from NYU. Mm-hmm. From NYU, right? So I think that I think of it very, very, very differently. Maybe there's another question?
I'd like to compliment the panel on a great discussion and presentation of great art.
That's why I'm on the panel, actually. Right. I'm hoping absolutely. That I can get a trade with Michelin.
and of course, to compliment the State Department's program, but I want to put it very quickly in the context of power and history. For some of us who traveled in Africa in the 1960s and would stop by embassies, there was a pretty clear message that these kinds of programs were for white people, and that the representation of art by women or representation of art by African Americans was not to be found on the embassy walls. And the reason it came to be found on embassy walls is because people like those of you in this room in the 1960s and into the 70s, struggled to make that happen. They asked questions. Why aren't there works by people of color in the embassies in Dakar or Lagos, and much less Japan and Rome? And I think it's an important lesson to keep in mind. There is a story that Quincy Jones tells, because Quincy led one of the big bands that toured for the State Department. And when they would go to some of the posts, Quincy would say that, the reception they got was great among most of the people at the embassy, but there were those who said, well, how come we're doing this black music? Why can't we do real good American music at the embassies? And so I think that one of the lessons I think we can take away from your great presentation today is that power concedes nothing without a struggle. And the fact that we've got great art that is present, whether it's at NYU or the State Department or other American institutions, is because American artists and their allies have insisted that American art cannot be American art unless it is fully inclusive. So I think that's a sort of nice link between the wonderful work that's happening now, what others will do in the future, but also the need to raise our voices so that we get to redefine what is great global as well as great American art. So again, all props to this great panel, and we look forward to another one in 10 years, which Deb will probably arrange for us at some point. Thank you very much.
Well stated. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Everyone, Carrie would like to just say one thing as we wait for the next panel.
First of all, you know, you cannot let a whole bunch of colored people get up. and expect them to sit back down anytime soon, right?
You know something, I really seriously want to say something. I just couldn't leave this stage today without saying this, and I'm so glad that this woman asked about this issue of compromise. There is no money. There's no money that could pay anyone to conceive an idea like this. What you are involved in, all of these wonderful feelings that you have, what you are witnessing, what you see evidence of, is the extraordinary love that Deb Willis the extraordinary love that Deb Willis has for her people. And we want to thank her. Thank you, Deb, for the labor of love, for the dedication, and for the commitment.
Absolutely. Thank you so much.